Mysterious Traveler. Written, produced, and directed by Robert A. Arthur and David Coleman. Starring one of radio's foremost actors, Cliff Carpenter.
This is the Mysterious Traveler inviting you to join me on another journey into the realm of the strange and the terrifying. I hope you will enjoy the trip, that it will thrill you a little and chill you a little.
At a speed of 15 miles an hour. And I, Stephen Reynolds, am responsible for the enemy's presence. I, and I alone, betrayed you. It wasn't intentional, and yet it's a small comfort to those of you fleeing for your lives. Before you condemn me, those of you who may still be hearing my voice, please listen and try to understand. Perhaps if you hear my story exactly as it happened, you may find it in your hearts to forgive me. It began a year ago at the Lindbrook Country Club, not far from the campus of State University. A banquet was being held in honor of Dr. Charles Warren in recognition of his vast contribution to organic chemistry. The main speaker at the banquet was the governor of the state, who was there to speak in tribute to Dr. Warren.
Who knows, Dr. Warren?
And his brilliant work can only join in the worldwide tribute that he has won with his discovery of neurium, the new miracle organic soil compound. Well, on this happy occasion, it is my privilege to bestow on Dr. Warren State University's highest award, the DuPage Medal of Science.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is indeed a happy moment in my life. For a scientist, there can be no greater reward than in serving his fellow men and bringing knowledge and light where there was none. The discovery of neurium begins a new era. For with this new organic compound, man is now able to revitalize soil that has been barren for hundreds of years. That the dream has become a reality, I owe largely to those of you who made my research through all these years possible. Without your kindness and invaluable aid, the discovery of neurium would not have been possible. Thank you.
Changed your mind about marrying me?
That's one thing I'll never change my mind about.
Oh, dear. I've never been so happy.
Nor I. You're going to have everything you want, Anne. A lovely home. Jewels. Servants.
I'll settle for this.
You've never known poverty, Anne. That's why you don't realize how important money is. We're going to have money, and a great deal of it, very soon.
Where is it coming from?
For the past few months, I've been working secretly on an experiment. If I meet with success, and I expect to, we'll be wealthy beyond our dreams.
An experiment? What sort of experiment,
Steve? Your father, after years of research, has discovered an organic compound that revitalizes barren soil. My experiment then approached the problem of food productivity on a different basis.
How?
Can you imagine what it would mean to mankind if a wheat crop could be grown in 2 weeks instead of the 4 months it takes? Think of 10 wheat crops a year where before there had been only two.
That's impossible.
Nothing's impossible. Think of it. Crops literally growing overnight. A food abundance such as the world has never known before.
But how?
I'm experimenting with a new chemical formula which has chlorophyll as its base. This formula will assist nature, accelerate the growth of plant life 100-fold. I've already had some small success, but I haven't reached the ultimate goal yet.
And when you do?
When I do, why, 1 gallon of this new formula sprayed over an acre of land will produce a crop almost overnight. I'll be world famous and a millionaire.
A millionaire?
Of course. This new formula of mine will perfect it and put your father's soil compound, neroleum. Well, it won't be very important in the face of my discovery.
Steve, this experiment, is it important because it'll be a great scientific advance? Or because it'll make you wealthy?
Why, I'm working for science and humanity, and you know that. But there's no harm in wanting to be wealthy, is there? I know now what I said to Anne wasn't true. I wasn't working for humanity. I was working for Steve Reynolds and the huge reward and honor that could be won. Yes, I wanted success more than anything else in life, no matter what the cost. In the months that followed, I worked day and night, rarely leaving the laboratory. One experiment followed another as I searched for the right formula. Then one day I was called by Dr. Warren's secretary and asked to come to his office.
Steve, I have here your progress report for the past 6 months. You seem to have made little, if any, progress in your study of soil erosion.
Well, to tell the truth, I've given up my study of soil erosion. I'm working on something else.
From your report, I guessed as much. Steve, I dislike saying this, but we can't ignore the obligations of your fellowship. I'm afraid I'll have to ask you on behalf of the trustees to give up whatever experiment you're engaged in.
I won't do it. I've been at it months, working day and night on this experiment. I'm too close to success now to give up.
Steve, the trustees...
When I've succeeded, and I will, I'll be world famous. Wealthy. One of the great scientists of all time.
I see.
You've got to keep that part of the support of mine from the trustees so that they don't interfere. There must be some excuse you can give them.
I'm sorry, Steve, but I must pass it along to them. Those are the rules.
I'm asking you to break the rules.
I can. Not for you, myself, or anyone else.
Anne has told you my experiments, hasn't she?
I know.
You don't want me to succeed, do you? That's why you won't help me.
Now, Steve, you're overworked. Nervous.
Otherwise, you just...
Nothing
wouldn't.
Will stop me, do you hear?
Not you, nor the trustees, or the whole university. I'll go on with my experiments, and I'll succeed.
Determined to achieve success with your blind or everything else. You've lost all sense of perspective.
Then you're on your father's side.
Yes, because he's right. You value fame and money above everything else.
And why not? Is there anything else in the world that counts?
Steve, you're like a stranger. Haven't I been married? It'd be a mistake.
Perhaps it would.
Where's the ring?
When I had left, I knew I was really alone. I moved my belongings into the farmhouse I'd rented and set up a small laboratory there. Went back to working day and night, for I knew it was a race against time. I had exactly $700 to my name, and once that was gone, I'd have to find a job. The weeks that followed were ones of unceasing work. One experiment followed another as I sought that elusive formula which would accelerate growth in plant life 100-fold. In those few moments of rest I took, I would think of Anne. Only my work kept me from going to her and apologized. Just a minute.
I couldn't stay away any longer knowing you were here all alone.
Have you forgiven me for the way I am?
Oh, yes. Darling, you don't look well at all. Your eyes are so bloodshot. You've lost weight.
Oh, I've been so busy half the time I forgot to eat.
How's your work coming?
Not so well. I'm on the right trail. I know I am, but I haven't been able to perfect the formula. I'm working on experiment 87 now.
How long can you go on?
You need to worry, Anne. Even if I wanted to go on, I can't. My money's just about gone.
Don't feel too badly about it.
Yeah, I'm so close to succeeding. I know I am.
But it isn't as though you can't pick up your experiments in the future, Steve. After you've had some rest and a chance to think everything out.
Yes, I suppose you're right. Come inside. I'll show you the lab I fixed.
No lab, Talon.
I haven't got the fancy equipment that was available at the university, but I do have everything I need. Here we are.
How crowded you are here.
Yes, you see, each experiment called for a small, separate box of earth. There are 87 boxes in the room. That's why it's so crowded. Over there's the box of formula number one. From there, the boxes run across the floor, too.
What's the matter, Steve?
Formula 87.
Formula 87.
That box over there. And look. Plant growth. Four sprouts.
Well, what about it, Steve?
This morning at 7 o'clock, I planted four seeds in this box. Then I injected the soil with formula 87.
This morning at 7?
Yes, it's now noon. These sprouts grew in 5 hours.
5 hours?
And I think I've succeeded. I found the formula.
Hmm. I have a strange feeling that I can see those sprouts growing from where I am.
They are.
Those sprouts, what are they?
Tomatoes. This rate of growth continues, and by noon tomorrow, these plants will have matured. And they'll be bearing ripe tomatoes.
Who is it?
It's Otter.
Oh, just a minute.
Good morning, Anne.
Hello.
Dr. Warren.
Anne told me of your amazing discovery, Steve. I hope you don't mind my coming here with us.
Hello. Of course not. Come in. I seem to have overslept. What time is it?
9 o'clock.
The tomato plant. Come along.
They're mature and bearing full-grown green tomatoes. And these plants are from the seeds you planted only yesterday morning?
Yes. Here are my notes. 7 a.m., 4 tomato seeds planted. 7:05, 250 cc, the formula 87 injected into the soil.
That's incredible. Simply incredible.
The
few more hours, those tomatoes will be ripe, ready to be eaten. Just 30 hours after I planted the seeds. Formula 87 will mean the end of famine. Word. My families will be able to grow their own fruits and vegetables almost overnight, using but a few square yards of earth.
Yes. Come out into the garden. There'll be more to see.
More to see?
Yes, yesterday afternoon after Ann left, I planted an acre of tomato seed and sprayed the acre with 5 gallons of Formula 87.
Look, Doctor. The acre is completely covered with half-grown tomato plants. By late this afternoon, those plants will have produced a crop of ripe tomatoes.
I wonder if you fully realize the implications of your discovery, Steve. It means the end of agricultural life as man has known it these thousands of years. With your discovery, a new era has begun for mankind.
Yes, as we stood there in the garden, there could be no question that every man, woman, and child on earth would be affected by my discovery. There's no urging on my part to have Dr. Warren and Ann stay on. They were too entranced to leave the garden and the plants that were growing before their very eyes. By 4 o'clock that afternoon, there was an acre of completely ripened tomatoes ready for consumption. Dr. Warren, Ann, and I returned to the house, and I persuaded them to stay overnight. We were all up at dawn, eager to see the plant growth that had taken place during the night. It was Dr. Warren who, as he led us into the garden, made the startling discovery.
Steve, look! What is it, Doctor? All I see is an acre of overripe tomatoes.
The plant life
surrounding the acre.
Well, there's nothing but dense overgrowth, Tyler. Weeds, vines, wild grasses.
Look how thick it is. And it's all 6 feet high.
You're right. Yesterday, there was nothing there to speak of. The weeds were just knee high.
Yes, I recall.
What does it mean?
Apparently, when I sprayed the acre where I planted, some of Formula 87 carried rubeon, causing those weeds and other plants to grow overnight to 6 feet.
The question now is, have they stopped growing?
Well, come along. Let's have a look.
The thickness of those weeds. The other plants are like a jungle growth.
A jungle growth. Yes, I was thinking the same. It's difficult to tell from here how far it extends.
Can't be more than those few feet where I sprayed beyond the acre.
Here we are.
So let's walk through it. See how deep it is.
All right.
The two of you had better follow the path I'm making. It's pretty good through here.
Yes. We're almost 30 feet into this growth. How much further does it extend?
I don't know. Can't tell yet.
That's our grass of the African growth.
Yes. We've come quite a way now. Can't even see the farmhouse behind us anymore.
It is so we are going in circles. It can't extend this far.
Well, we're walking a straight line. I've been following the sun.
Dad, how far do you think we've come?
Oh, at least 100 yards.
Well, the growth is beginning to thin out. I think we've reached the outer fringe of it.
Here's the field. Well,
thank goodness we're out of that.
Steve, do you realize how many acres that growth covers?
At least 10 acres, and it all sprang up since late yesterday afternoon. What do you make of it, Doctor?
This Formula 87 of yours not only accelerates the growth of plant life 100-fold where sprayed, but also affects the surrounding acreage.
What is it in Formula 87 that causes it to spread?
You must realize, Anne, that in this new formula, we're dealing with the unknown. Well, perhaps Steve can explain why it caused such a growth on an additional 10 acres.
No, I can't, Doctor. Much a puzzle to me as it is to you.
What are you doing, Steve?
Just following up a few small watch to mark how far the growth extends.
As of this moment.
As of this moment?
Yes, Anne. For even a few minutes we stood here, the growth is continuing. It is spreading.
Bill Storm with the 9 o'clock news. Well, startling news has been coming in over the press wires in the last 10 minutes. A young associate professor, Stephen Reynolds of State University, discovered a new chemical formula which has the power to accelerate plant life growth 100-fold.
While engaged in experiments on his farm 20 miles outside of Statesville, Professor Reynolds sprayed an acre of land with his new discovery, Formula 87. One of the amazing results of this experiment was the growth overnight of a one-acre crop of tomatoes. But another result, which seems almost incredible to this reporter, is the news that Formula 87 caused plant life in surrounding acreage to grow overnight into a fantastic growth and become so thick and profuse as to cause on-the-spot observers to compare it to jungle growth. Even more amazing, the growth seems to be spreading in all directions at the rate of 100 acres an hour. Already, it has spread over 2,000 acres of land. Agricultural experts and scientists are being rushed to the scene of this phenomenon. Stay tuned for further news flashes during the day.
Steve.
Yes, Doctor?
Did the dynamite give any results?
None at all.
Oh, here comes the governor.
There you are, Dr. Warren. All right, what's the latest word?
Now, the growth is now spreading at the rate of a mile an hour in every direction.
Why, that means thousands of acres of valuable land turning into jungle every hour.
Yes, and what's more, it's spreading at an accelerated speed. By evening, it'll be spreading at a rate of 3 miles an hour.
Haven't you been able to do anything to stop it?
Well, we've tried dynamite fire all to no avail. I have the best scientific brains in the country working on the problem, but as yet we haven't been able to determine what it is that's causing this wild growth to spread.
Young man, this catastrophe is of your doing. Have you any ideas what is causing this growth to spread in such a frightening manner?
I'm not certain, but I think Formula 87 created a new type of pollen. And it's the pollen which is spreading this growth.
A new type of pollen? Well, what makes you think that, Steve?
I just got a report that the growth has crossed the Ardmore River and it's spread to the other bank.
The Ardmore River? Well, that's half a mile wide.
Yes, and that's why I'm convinced it's a pollen of some sort that's carrying this plant.
You're probably right. Well, can't you come up with a new spray? Something that will stop it?
We'll do what we can, Governor. We're not losing a minute.
What's going to happen, Doctor, when this jungle growth reaches villages and towns? We've already had to evacuate farmers.
Yes, yes. We'll work day and night, Governor, to find the answer to all this.
At the fantastic rate it's spreading, I'd better order out our National Guard and ask for assistance from Washington.
This is Bill Storm, speaking to you from the state capitol. Well, the green plague continues to advance. And Governor Thomas has declared a state emergency. Martial law has been imposed with the full approval of Washington. The green plague has spread over an area of 40,000 acres. Four villages and two towns were evacuated shortly before they were engulfed by this advancing jungle growth, which scientists have been unable to explain or halt. These scientists state that the growth is accelerating its advance from hour to hour and is now moving at a rate of 15 miles an hour. Meanwhile, on-the-spot observers state that plants, vines, and trees are literally springing up before their very eyes, and that this fantastic and relentless growth is crushing and destroying all that which lies before it. All residents of the state capital have been evacuated, and momentarily we expect orders to abandon this station. However, full news reports will be continuously broadcast from other stations. Meanwhile, reports from Washington indicate that... Oh... Ladies and gentlemen, I have just received the signal that this station is to be abandoned. Tune in to other stations for further news flashes.
Steve, we better leave the studio at the station.
Leave? Look, you two had better come with me. You heard me broadcast. We're abandoning this station.
Come on, Steve.
Well, what about those people who may not have been tuned in? May not know about the green plague?
Look, Mr. Reynolds, I've done what I was told to do. I'm not responsible for people who didn't hear my warnings.
But I am.
What? Oh, you mean because...
Yes.
Well, we'd better get going. There's no time to discuss this.
Is the equipment still on?
Yes, why?
And you leave it with the storm. I'll follow later.
What are you going to do?
Some people may tune into the station, may not know what's happening. I'm going to stay here a while longer, broadcast the warning.
Then I'll stay too.
Look, I'm leaving. You'd better make up your minds in a hurry.
We'll stay for a while.
Okay, if that's the way you want it. So long.
Still not too late to change your mind.
No. Go ahead.
Any of you are still listening in, this is Stephen Reynolds speaking to you from the state capitol. This is to warn you that a terrible force of nature has been unleashed. I, and I alone, am responsible for what has happened. That's a small comfort to those of you fleeing for your lives, unable to understand the disaster that was brought about by my experiments. Experiments I was interested in for a personal gain, not for the advancement of science and humanity. Perhaps that's the reason.
Please.
The green plague. The sweet town.
That's not here.
Give me your hand.
Steve, it sounds almost like an earthquake.
Yes. This way to the street.
The trees. The bushes are growing before our very eyes. There's an uprooting of buildings.
Look. The building across the street.
It's going to come down. Run!
Again, I take this same train every week at this same time.
You have just heard The Mysterious Traveler. Now you can enjoy other tense and exciting stories of The Mysterious Traveler in the current issue of The Mysterious Traveler magazine, now available. All characters in our story are fictitious. Any resemblance to actual persons or name or otherwise is purely coincidental. Music is under the direction of Emerson Buckley, composed by Richard U. Page. Bill Tonkin speaking. This program came to you from New York.